By tomorrow morning, this beach will be packed, as it has been for every significant launch, because this is Cocoa Beach in Florida, the closest to the Kennedy Space Center and the launch pad of the Space Shuttle. This beach has seen everything from the first American in space to the Apollo mission that put Neil Armstrong on the moon, and of course, every shuttle launch. Shuttle is magnificent, of course, but it's really a delivery van. It's a way of getting stuff up to the space station. When people were inspired by space, they think of Apollo, they think of the moon landings. That was what really inspired the space fans, the enthusiasts, the billionaires, people like me, into science. And the shuttle never really did that. Your average shuttle launch was never very memorable, and neither was the shuttle particularly good at the frequent, cheap space hops it promised. But its friends say it was still a pioneer.
I mean, the shuttle, it's huge. It's like a big airplane. And the fact that it did not turn out to be as inexpensive as people hoped and that we couldn't fly it as frequently, well, you know, it was the first generation. Nobody knew how to build a reusable spaceship.
So is it time for a radical change in gear to open up space to more than just elite astronauts? In the 1960s, that's what I was promised. Space travel would be for everybody, for you and for me. And here in the Rockies, they think they might have a way to do that. In the basement at Colorado University, there's a team using NASA money and an old NASA spacecraft to try to fly people into space. It's headed by a veteran of 5 shuttle missions.
Hello.
Oh, hello, Susan.
You must be Jim.
Yes, welcome
Hi,
to
nice
the Dream
to meet
Chaser.
You. Thank you very much.
That's the ship we're in. Actually, not that one. It's a scale model. This one, a mock-up tucked into the corner.
I left NASA in 2003 and went to teach at a university. And after a few years of that, I was convinced to come back and work in the new commercial space industry to attempt to take this vehicle off the shelf from what NASA had done, to use modern technology and materials to make it into a new spacecraft to use for a human spacecraft to take humans to the International Space Station and back. In zero gravity, it's very nice. We would just float very gently towards the end of the tunnel and it would be plenty of room.
So in terms of what you've actually done experimentally with this craft, what's this about up here?
Well, this is a model of the Dream Chaser.
Good drop.
They dropped the 1/5 scale model from 40,000 feet. It flew autonomously and then parachuted back to Earth.
You've got a good shoot.
Copy, good shoot.
They're also building a full-size version for structural tests. But back in the lab, they're working out how best to lay out the controls in a cockpit mock-up, which looks, as they say in America, proudly homemade.
Just pull back gently, and our nose will pitch up a little bit, and we'll very softly, oh, wonderful landing. This is how you start programs like this. The students actually started off with cardboard. They cut up boxes to make their first cockpit and made the panels. Because it's very cheap, they spent $20 on the first panel displays. But they get the idea from that, and then they built this more rigid structure with all the panels and the switches that they can replace. These will come out so that they can, well, I can't take that one out, but they come out like this so you can swap them out with others, and then they can test different types of switches.
People will look at this and they'll think, well, this is not really NASA, is it?
No, but it is. NASA does the same thing, but they spend a lot more money doing the same thing that we've done. This cost us $30,000 total. The quality of the evaluations they did was as good as anything I've ever seen at NASA.
The Dream Chaser project has $20 million of NASA money, and just today signed a deal to take off and land at the Kennedy Space Center as it becomes a commercial spaceport. And it depends on buying a NASA rocket for launch. Out here in the Californian desert, there are people who prefer an approach that evokes the spirit not of the 60s, but the 1950s.
It's doing away with all the bureaucracy, it's doing away with the big bucks, the slow timetable, it's back to workshops, that kind of, we can do it, let's do it quickly and cheaply mentality.
In Mojave, a strange mix of rocket companies has settled down, from those cutting up old military jets to those who've already reached the final frontier. The people here want a more step-by-step approach than NASA's grand projects. And why is this place unique?
Well, it's just a few miles from Edwards Air Force Base, where test pilots flew into the unknown, breaking the sound barrier and then on to the edge of space, before NASA even existed. The big boys are already here at Mojave. Over there in that hangar is Virgin Spaceship 2. But over here, we have a company that wants to take people to space for about half the price, in that ship.
If you want to hop on the cockpit, I'll give you a little tour.
That was another model, but inside, this one is a rocket plane they've already flown in.
You actually fit pretty good. You could be a rocket pilot.
All of you guys had a chance to ride in this one, is it right?
Yeah, actually, the other one, the rocket racer, we all had a ride in.
And what did that feel like?
Well, it's pretty amazing. When you tow out to the runway, you are in a very quiet airplane. There's nothing running yet. You know, there's no jet engine whine. There's no propeller. And you're towed out, and then you're looking straight down this 12,500-foot runway. And then, okay, here we go. 3, 2, 1. And he hits the switch, and all of a sudden, your head is just pinned to the seat. It's amazing.
And what's the link between what you're doing and those old X-planes?
They did things similarly to how we did, which was to do incremental testing, test a little, don't make something giant, just start small. We did that and proved that we could build something that we felt that was safe enough to put someone in it that we trusted.
Their first two planes were not designed to go into space, but their third craft, the Lynx, still under construction, will be. But only for suborbital flights, a much easier proposition. In another part of Mojave, there's a team working on a completely different approach, moving away from planes to something much simpler, using capsules on top of rockets. So what are you actually doing here, Randa?
This is a test lift of a single common propulsion module. And we call it a common propulsion module because this is the central building component for all our rockets. Five of these CPMs, as we call them, would be bundled together into our satellite launcher called the Neptune 30. It's called that because it lifts 30 kilograms to low Earth orbit.
This is crunch year for Randa and her husband, Rod. They've been at Mojave for 16 years and plan their first orbital launch for the autumn, which they say is sold out. Cheap satellites come first, but by 2014, they plan to send people up too.
This is our six-person capsule. We will take a pilot and five crew members to low Earth orbit.
So 2014, that's very ambitious. I mean, we're standing here in front of this, you know, wooden mock-up.
Yeah.
How are you going to convince people that you're going to get to that stage of being ready for flight in, what, 3 short years?
Something like that, yeah. We have ongoing programs that are going to demonstrate the viability of these rockets, first of all with our satellite launch vehicles. That'll be a great confidence builder. We're looking to travel ourselves, so we want to make this as safe and reliable as possible, and that's why we've built rockets that are so radically simplified in their systems that they will be the safest types of vehicles around.
So do you think you'll be one of the first passengers?
Not the first, because we'll be conducting the launch.
Well, at the moment, these smaller companies are really not ready, but maybe it is time now to give them a few years, see if they can have a shot at that dream of making space available to more people, people like you and me. The future may belong to these smaller outfits, but to those who played a part in the Shuttle years, there's a lot to be proud of. The mission to repair the Hubble telescope is perhaps the most memorable, and the man who walked in space to fix Hubble agrees.
I've launched satellites, I've done science experiments, I've operated a tether satellite, I've done spacewalks, I've fixed Hubble. I mean, I've had a great time.
And maybe he's right. There's a lot to remember about the Shuttle years.
If you should ever leave me, the life would still go on.
The shuttle may have failed to bring spaceflight to the masses. At over $500 million a launch, it was never going to do that. But it still had its moments.